please join me in the call to worship? Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations.
From everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
You make all things new in heaven and on earth.
We come to you, ending one year, beginning another, with new desires and old fears, new decisions and old controversies, new dreams and old weaknesses.
Because you are a God of hope, we know that you create all the possibilities of the future.
Because you are a God of love, we know that you accept all the mistakes of the past.
Because you are the God of our faith, we enter your gates with thanksgiving and praise.
We come into your presence
with gladness and joy. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Kathy Brady, and I am a lay servant at this church. A lot of you may not be very familiar with me because I hang out at second service generally. I'm a flute player there. But Steve asked me to come and speak today because he and Ann are celebrating their wedding anniversary. It's a good reason to take a weekend off. We are here today because God is great and God is mighty. And we're here to give praise and lift up things that matter to us. And what we know is that our God is a God who cares about the small things that we're able to do, the small things that we're able to offer. And through the service, hopefully, we will be inspired to do what we can. It's now time for the bell choir. Thank you.
Children to come forward for a couple minutes with me.
Hi, Miss Anne. Might just be you. Emmett, are you gonna come over? Or you can watch from there, that's okay. Oh, here comes Thomas. Fantastic. Well, I'm so glad to see all of you. Right. So, you know what? I'm still in the mood for a celebration. Look, I even brought a balloon. Do you know what my balloon says? You know what that says? Thomas, can you help out? What does my balloon say?
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday! Are we celebrating somebody's birthday? Did you just recently celebrate somebody's birthday? I did. No? Am I the only one who just celebrated somebody's birthday? 2 weeks ago.
ago. It was somebody's birthday that we celebrated.
Whose birthday was 2 weeks ago?
This is not a trick question.
Jesus, I knew you were here for a reason, Thomas. Thanks. Yeah, believe it or not, 2 weeks ago we celebrated Jesus' birthday.
Remember Christmas, presents, maybe you had a tree in your house, maybe you still do.
Yeah, but guess what? That party's not over yet. Do you know why? Because you remember my story that we told before Christmas? Remember we had Mary, and we had Joseph, and we had a baby Jesus? Well, there's more people to my story. You want to hold one? Perfect. The story continues. So the story continues that there were wise men. And you know what? They saw a star. They saw a star in the east, and they needed to follow that star. Where do you think that star led them?
To Jesus.
To Jesus. Yep. And we celebrate that day. Actually, that day was on Friday. 12 days after Christmas. That's where we get the song, the 12 days of Christmas. It's Epiphany, and that's to remember that the wise men came with gifts, just like it was a birthday party. They came with gifts to Jesus. Now, they followed a star. Here, you can have a wise man, Thomas. Can we look around? Do you see a star anywhere in this church? In this room?
Right there.
Right there. Do you see it? So we have to take our wise men and follow the star. Will you help me? Okay. Emmett, you want to take one of the wise men? You want to follow the star with us? Okay, we're going to go follow the star. Okay, let's go.
Okay.
Now it's time to bring our joys and concerns before the Lord. Does anyone have a praise they would like to share today?
The sun is shining.
The sun is shining. And last I checked, the Packers were still in the running. I see some fans out there. Yeah. Anybody else? Anybody else? Yeah. A new job? Okay. Praise for a new job. Anybody else? Yeah. And you're too much of a gentleman to tell us which one, but thank you and happy birthday. Anybody else? All right, what kinds of concerns do we have that we'd like to raise to God today? Yes.
For my uncle and cousins.
Oh, okay. Family loss, thank you. If you can pray with me for a moment. Dear Lord, we come before you today with joy for the ways that people have reached out to us and the opportunities that you have provided us. We celebrate jobs and birthdays and gifts and thoughtfulness, but we also come to you with heavy heart for those who have experienced loss in their family. And we ask your healing power, Lord, for Heather, Kelly, and all of those who are suffering physical and mental illness. As your children, we know that you hear every word that we say. We're large and we are small, but our concerns weigh heavily on your heart. We are grateful to come to you today and safe in the knowledge that you hold us high regard and provide us with love that we cannot understand. We bring our prayers to you in the name of your Son. Amen. If you will join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now we come to the time in the service when we bring forth our offering.
Let us listen to the word of God from the chapter of Matthew. Jesus was born in the town of Bethlehem in the province of Judea at the time when King Herod reigned. Not long after Jesus was born, magi, wise men, and seers from the east made their way from the east to Jerusalem. These wise men made inquiries. Where is this newborn? Who is the king of the Jews? When we were far away in the east, we saw a star, and we have followed its glistening and gleam all the way to worship him. King Herod began to hear rumors of the wise men's quest, and he and all of his followers in Jerusalem were worried. So Herod called all the leading Jewish teachers, the chief priests, and head scribes, and he asked them where Hebrew tradition claimed that long-awaited anointed one would be born. An ancient Hebrew prophet, Micah, said this, "But you in Bethlehem in the land of Judea are no poor relation, for from your people will come a ruler, and you will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Herod called the wise men to him, demanding to know the exact time the special star had appeared to them. Then Herod sent them to Bethlehem. "Go to Bethlehem and search high and low for the Savior child. And soon as you know where he is, report it to me so that I may go and worship him." The wise men left Herod's chambers and went on their way. The star they had first seen in the east reappeared. A miracle that, of course, overjoyed and enraptured the wise men. The star led them to the house where Jesus lay. And as soon as the wise men arrived, they saw him with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. They unpacked their satchels and gave Jesus gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And then, just as Jesus did a few months before, the wise men had a dream warning them not to go back to Herod. The wise men heeded the dream. Ignoring Herod's instructions, they returned to their homes in the east by a different route. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Sorry.
going to attempt to steer the technology from up here, and it looks like it's going to work. I'd always heard about grandparents armed with brag books telling friends, family, and complete strangers on the street about their grandchildren. Although I don't have a brag book, I do have a PowerPoint presentation. Meet Maxwell Nicholas Martin, my 2-month-old grandson. He's topping the scales at roughly 10.5 pounds right now, but when he was born on October 20th, he was a tiny 5 pounds, 10 ounces. Then he began to lose weight, down to a very petite 5 pounds, 5 ounces, before he began his climb back up the scales. Christmas had a much different meaning for me this year. I had had 2 of my own babies, but they were born at a very average 7 pounds, 9 ounces each and arrived in February and March respectively, so they were healthy chunks by Christmas time. But the opportunity to see Max so small and yet so perfect gave me a lot to reflect on. We're certainly not covering any new territory here with the fact that the Savior of the world was born as a helpless infant to a poor couple who had no shelter. Author and pastor Max Lucado might sum it up best when he describes that cold evening that we have come to call Christmas. The pain has been eclipsed by wonder. Mary looks into the face of the baby, her son, her Lord, his majesty. At this point in history, the human being who best understands who God is and what he is doing is a teenage girl in a smelly stable. She can't take her eyes off him. Somehow Mary knows she is holding God. So this is he. She remembers the words of the angel, "His kingdom will never end." He looks anything but a king. His face is prunish and red. His cry, though strong and healthy, is still the helpless and piercing cry of a baby. And he is absolutely dependent on Mary for his well-being. As I said, we've spent a lot of time marveling at how God came to earth as a tiny baby, but perhaps we don't spend enough time thinking about all the forms that God could have taken to save the world. He could have taken the form of a giant like Goliath to overtake the world and mold it and shape it into what he thought it should be. Or instead, he could have ridden down from heaven on a throne encased with jewels to represent the true king that he is, and used wealth and power to craft the world into the vision he had for it. But that just wouldn't have been God's style. In terms of God's story as spelled out in the Bible, Jesus enters fairly late. We have the entire Old Testament to get used to how God does things. When God needed a great and honest king, he turned to a young shepherd boy named David, who slayed a giant and eventually became a powerful leader. When God needed to save the world through its near destruction, he turned to a humble, quiet man named Noah to build an ark, who, all the while he worked, was subjected to the ridicule of all of his society. When God needed to save a nation from starvation, he chose Joseph, a young boy who had been sold into slavery by his wicked brothers. Although all these people weren't necessarily small in stature, they were small in the eyes of their society. They were overlooked and dismissed. God likes to start small and work up to big. So what can we learn from that? The message is clear. No matter how small, God will provide whatever is necessary for those who believe in him. In our reading for today, the helpless baby Jesus and his parents are at great risk. Herod, the evil king, tries to trick the wise men in the scripture into helping him find Jesus. He wove an evil tale to the 3 kings about wanting to worship Jesus when he really desired to kill the newborn. Actually, we don't know how many kings there were because the scripture doesn't say, but because the hymn and our beautiful manger scene both feature 3 kings, 3 kings it is. God came to the kings in a dream after they had worshipped the Christ child to be sure that they understood the danger Herod represented to the tiny baby and his parents. We don't need to be big because God is. We don't need to be powerful because God is. See how that works? He has our back. All we have to do is believe. This is what I like to call the power of small. But it doesn't stop with our lack of stature or our limited impact on society. The power of small can also serve as a critical reminder of how much the little things do matter. Think about that bad day you were having when a server, your mail carrier, or the checkout clerk at the grocery store asked you how you were, and they really meant it. Or after a bad day at work, you cringe at opening up the mailbox, worried about the bills that you might find there. And while you probably do find some bills, you also find a note from a friend reaching out and providing that boost you were looking for all day. Extending small kindnesses is something we can do. You don't need to have influence, money, or physical prowess to make a big difference by a small act. We have the perfect role model for this behavior. Although we tend to think of Jesus' ability to perform amazing miracles, like raising the dead or healing the sick, he was also the master of the small kindness. In analyzing Jesus Christ's ability to powerfully extend kindnesses, I am reminded of a great line from my favorite MASH character. Father Francis Mulcahy was approaching the mess tent when he saw a very smelly Hawkeye and BJ eating outside. The two captains had taken time off from hygiene to protest their tent mate Charles's new hobby, French horn playing. It seems that their refusal to bathe was not very popular with their fellow camp residents, and both stinky men were enjoying fresh air and their meal outside at the request of those trying to dine in. When Father Mulcahy sees the two smelly rebels, he says, "Ah, eating outside, I see. Very chic. Reminds me of the Via Veneto in Rome. I dined al fresco when we went there for an audience with the Pope." An incredulous BJ says, "The Pope?" Rather proudly, Father Mulcahy says, "Numero uno." Excited about the prospect of the company of someone besides BJ, Hawkeye says hopefully, "Pull up a crate and tell us about it, Father." Hesitantly, Father Mulcahy answers, "No, I'm expected inside." Remorsefully, BJ asks, "Father, is it because we smell bad?" Again, sounding hesitant, the good father responds, "Well, oh dear, how should I put this? Yes, because of that." Proud to demonstrate his biblical knowledge, Hawkeye says, "Jesus ate with the lepers." As he opened the door to the mess tent, Father Mulcahy answered insistently, "He was an exceptionally good sport." Jesus was and is a great role model for us precisely because he is a good sport. We may get lost in the miracles and say, "I can't be like Christ. I can't heal the sick and raise the dead." What we might fail to notice is that much of the power and impact of what Christ did didn't come from him being an incarnation of God himself. Much of the power and impact came from Christ being human, a really good, really kind human. We can do that. It's the power of small. Christ understood that better than anybody. Think about the healing of the leper. Yes, Christ healed him, and that's likely out of our wheelhouse. But before he healed him, Christ touched the leper. This man who had been ostracized found in Jesus acceptance and the gift of human touch. That's something right up our alley. We can do that. We likely won't have the opportunity to interact with lepers, but we do have the opportunity to talk with others whom society has shunned for one reason or another. the poor, the homeless, the infirmed, the list goes on. A kind word, a friendly handshake, the sharing of a smile and some spare change could change a life, or at least make that life more bearable in the moment. We can do that. Again, Jesus is a great role model for this. The Bible is full of examples of Jesus eating with undesirables, folks simply labeled as sinners and tax collectors. The tax collectors of the day weren't ancient versions of IRS employees, government employees who don't make the rules, but instead simply carry out the tax law of our country. Tax collectors did indeed collect tax money from the citizens on behalf of the Roman Empire. The difference between Roman tax collectors and IRS employees, though, is that with every collection, the tax collectors of the day made sure to add a cut for themselves on the top. A tip, if you will. A very generous, sizable, mandatory, painful to pay tip. So these people were hated among society, and perhaps not without reason. Imagine the shock of everyone around Jesus as he ate with these people they found so deplorable. But to the Savior of the world, his reason for doing so was simple. In Mark 2:17, Jesus very simply explains, "People who have their health don't need to see a doctor. Only those who are sick do. I'm not here to call those already in good standing with God. I'm here to call sinners to turn back to him." The sinless Son of God didn't judge these people. Instead, he showed them kindness and compassion, which changed lives. We aren't sinless ourselves, so it makes sense that judgment on our part would be wholly unacceptable and ineffective, too. Jesus touched lives, all often through the power of human kindness alone. We can do that. Why? Because little things matter to God. There is nothing that escapes his notice or concern. We know this. The book of Matthew famously talks about God's attention to the sparrows. Look, if you sold a few sparrows, how much money would you get? A copper coin apiece, perhaps? And yet your Father in heaven knows when these small sparrows fall to the ground. You, beloved, are worth so much more than a whole flock of sparrows. God knows everything about you, even the number of hairs on your head. So do not fear. It's easy to think in the day-to-day hustle that we can't do anything of import to help others. Good grief. Sometimes it takes all my effort just to help myself, and I don't do that very well some days. But the Bible makes it pretty clear that kindness is what God wants from us. According to the prophet Micah, kindness is far more important to God than the burnt offerings of the day. Would the Eternal be pleased by thousands of sacrificial rams, by 10,000 swollen rivers of sweet olive oil? No. He has told you mortals what is good in his sight. What else does the Eternal ask of you but to live justly and to love kindness and to walk with your true God in all humility? And the New Testament letter to the Hebrews goes so far as to remind us that we should show kindness to everyone we meet because we might be surprised about who they really are. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for by this some have entertained angels without knowing it. And ultimately, Matthew quotes the Son of Man, "I tell you this, whenever you saw a brother or sister hungry or cold, whatever you did to the least of these, so you did to me." So we know that the power of small means that the little kindnesses we show to each other matter, to that person, and especially to God, who will smile at his children, care for each other. It is important and comforting to know that we don't have to be super Christians like Joan of Arc or Mother Teresa to be able to make a difference in the lives of others. But there's more to the power of small than kindness. It has a darker side, too. The thoughtless little things we do out of carelessness, envy, greed, or neglect carry as much weight as their much sunshinier counterparts. We never know where those around us are in their lives at any given moment. A stranger could be very fragile. And while our kindness might save the day, our thoughtlessness could destroy it. I experienced an example of this when my son was deployed to Afghanistan. I've shared with you before that during that time, I had such maternal agony that I truly danced on the edge of madness. My soul was on fire, and it took all my strength to leave the house. I was afraid the dreaded government vehicle might come to my home, and what would happen if I wasn't there? It wasn't logical, but there was very little about my thinking that was logical during those 9 months. I drove a town away from where I lived to attend a church rummage sale. I won't mention what church it was. I will only tell you, thankfully, it wasn't this one. I tried to enjoy the sunshine of the afternoon and the nice selection of items the church members had laid out for reasonable prices. I found a black suede Bible cover for a dollar that I still use to this day, and a few other items as well. What comes next is a blur to me. I know that I had an exchange with one of the women running the sale, and I know she said something unkind. So trivial was it that my brain failed to record what was said. But I do remember was the hurt. I am confident that the woman had no intention to be less than Christian. Her mild teasing or thoughtlessness, though, ripped through my already bleeding and scarred soul. And I cried all the way back home, feeling abandoned by everyone who didn't understand. And because this lady was representing a Christian church, in that moment, I felt abandoned by God, too. That's the power of small. It can heal or wound, depending on how it's used. It really is quite a responsibility to move through the world as a child of God. Because when we get it right, people can feel the love of Christ wrapped around them. And when we get it wrong, they may feel lost, alone, and far away from God. I will close today with an anonymous poem that resides on the internet. I have wept in the night for the shortness of sight that to somebody's need made me blind, but I never have yet felt a tinge of regret for being a little too kind.
Next Sunday, the women of the church are asked to bring Kleenexes, a box of Kleenexes, unopened, of course. And there is going to be a picture taken at 10 o'clock. This is from Marilyn Eister. Let's box them up and stack them up and intercept the traffickers. So don't forget to bring your Kleenexes next week. You want to stand, please?
To bring compassion, to set the king.
forth this week mindful of how big God is and how powerful he can make the small things that we are able to do. We go forth in his son's name. Amen.